Hello everyone, welcome to the WebEVTalk. Welcome back. We're starting the second half of the year. And I hope everyone is excited as I am for today's talk. So just a housekeeping thing. So just letting you know that WebEVTalk is now on Patreon. So this is allowing us to receive support or sponsorship from you guys, either from individual or institutes or societies or industry. So if you're interested, you can check the Patreon website, and you can also email us directly to find out. So I'd like to thank Horiba Scientific, who is our first patron. Thank you very much for sponsoring WebEVTalk. So today is the 1st June 2021. We have Professor Dr. Eva-Maria Krämer-Albers from University Mainz, Germany. Eva-Maria received a PhD in molecular and cellular neuroscience from the University of Heidelberg, Germany, and was further trained in neurogenetics at the Max Planck Institute of Experimental Medicine in Göttingen. So since 2006, Eva-Maria is heading a research group at the Johannes Gutenberg University in Mainz. She's studying the role of EV in neural cell communication. And in 2015, she discovered the release of EVs into the circulation during exercise. She served as an associate editor for the Journal of Extracellular Vesicles between 2012 and 2019. And is currently a vice president of the German Society of Extracellular Vesicles, or GCEF. So thank you so much, Eva. Today she's going to present her lecture on extracellular vesicles released during exercise, or ExerVs, multisource, multitasked, and multisystemic signaling vehicles on missions for health. So welcome, Eva.
As Carolina mentioned, actually, and many of you may wonder why I will talk today about EVs released during exercise, because most of you maybe rather know me for the work as a neuroscientist and our work in on EVs in cellular crosstalk in the nervous system. And so this work I'm going to present today is a fruitful collaboration with the Department of Sports Medicine from the University of Mainz, who got interested in extracellular vesicles about 10 years ago because they were working on cell-free DNA and they wanted to know where actually their cell-free DNA is coming from and whether this is associated with extracellular vesicles. So we started this collaboration, and today I would like to carry you through what we found during this endeavor. And so the vesicles released during exercise, we like to term them ExerVs, since we think there are not enough names for EVs out there yet. Yeah, so, but I think that's not a problem. It's a subpopulation, a very defined subpopulation of EVs. I think this name fits quite well to define this. So those of you that may regular exercise, and you maybe feel this every day, that exercise has a multisystemic effect on our body. So in response to exercise, there is a multisystemic response, an adaptive response, and many organ systems are involved in this response. From muscle over liver, the metabolism is affected, the cardiovascular system, the adipose tissue, again, metabolism, and also the brain. And this response is associated with many, many health benefits. And it's protecting from all kinds of diseases, from cancer to neurodegenerative disease. So for those of us working in the EV field, it's actually quite obvious that we immediately think whether this kind of organ crosstalk may be mediated, at least in part, I'm not saying that it's completely mediated, but at least in part by EVs. If we look at confirmed EV functions, we know they are involved in immune modulation, in cardiovascular protection, in tissue regeneration, and it has even been shown that they can enter from the periphery into the brain. And I would like to remind you of the very beautiful work of Stefan Momma's group, who showed that EVs coming from the periphery, and this is a genetic system that is proving that using the Cree system, that EVs coming from the periphery can actually enter the brain and signal, in this case, to neurons. And this newest study actually shows that this is dependent on neuronal activity also, and it's also dependent on inflammatory signaling. So, taking this together, I think EVs are really very hot candidates to play a role in this, in mediating these systemic effects in response to exercise, which we all know are protective and have a high biomedical relevance to get more insight how this is molecularly mediated. So EVs in the circulation, we find all types of EVs from exosomes, shedding microvesicles or apoptotic bodies. And these EVs are coming from largely from the cells that are associated with the circulation, endothelial cells, monocytes, neutrophils, and largely platelets. Erythrocytes are missing here. And so platelets and red blood cells, they together make up the largest part of EVs that are found in the circulation. But also, of course, other leukocytes and EVs from the surrounding tissues are found within the circulation. So I think there is a debate about the concentration of EVs that can be determined in plasma. I think most studies overestimate the EV concentration because it's mixed up with other particles in the blood. I'm coming to this in a few minutes in the next slides. So I think the most, believable range would be maybe between 500 and 50,000 EVs per microliter, which was determined, I think, in this study quite well using electron microscopy. So, and also the turnover in the circulation, it seems that they are not that stable. They stay there for between few minutes to hours. And I think also our studies will add some information to this turnover time. So the functions I was addressing already, so let's move to the next slide. So when we look at particles in the circulation, we, of course, have to talk about other particles, on top of EVs. So there are lipoprotein particles, and they actually outnumber EVs by several orders of magnitude. And the problem is that they overlap in size and in density, and this makes the separation of EVs from these particles, and in particular from lipoproteins, really, really highly challenging. This is demonstrated here on these slides. So the EVs, they have different sizes, and the particles, the lipoprotein particles, have similar overlapping sizes, but also overlapping densities. So with genuine biochemical separation methods, it's going to be difficult to clearly separate these particles. And this can also be seen here on this electron microscopy image, where we looked at size exclusion isolated or separated EVs from the circulation. And you can see some EVs, they are very heterogeneous in size, but around there, and actually, as I said, most of the lipoproteins are separated away by the size exclusion chromatography technology, but there are still numerous lipoproteins around there. And this has to be considered when working with EVs isolated or separated from the circulation. So back in 2015, we published a pilot study on exercise and EVs. So there we used differential ultracentrifugation to isolate EVs from plasma. And we performed an incremental exercise test where blood was taken before exercise, and then people were subjected to, as I said, incremental exercise with stepwise increases of the workload until exhaustion. And so we took blood before exercise, after exercise, and 90 minutes after a rest period, and then looked at plasma subjected to differential centrifugation with an additional 2.2 micrometer filtration step and 100,000 G pellet with an additional wash step, actually, to isolate small EVs. And when looking at these EVs by, let's say, nanoparticle tracking analysis at that time, we were quite happy to see that after exercise, we could see an increase in the number of particles, and which was back to normal after 90 minutes. But I have to say, this kind of picture, we have published this and we have found this really at that time. I'm coming to this at the end of the presentation. We cannot reproduce this when using other technologies and isolating EVs. And now we think NTA is not appropriate method to measure EVs in the circulation. I think we are measuring other things here. But when looking at Western blotting, we could see several markers that were increasing post-exercise that are known to be associated with small EVs. And they were down to almost the baseline after 90 minutes of rest. So you see the two red marked individuals. These were individuals that were above 30, and I think their response was lower. So the group there in this pilot study was quite heterogeneous. Where I really started to get interested in this problem is where we looked at each increment of the exercise test. So you can see here the increase in workload, and then we isolated at each increment the small EVs and had a look at them and quantified them. And here you can see an increase of these markers over time. And when you plot this, and the red curve is the lactate curve, and when you then look at the EV curve, you can see they actually rise before the lactate. And at this time, I really thought this must be a really active release mechanism that is independent of the metabolic stress that arises together with the acidification of the blood. So there, I thought this, and seeing that this was reproducible also over several times, I really got interested, and I thought there is a real mechanism behind that. So, as I said, there were some flaws in these studies. First of all, the subjects were quite heterogeneous, and the isolation technology at that time, it was gold standard, but nowadays, of course, ultracentrifugation is not the gold standard anymore. Current best practice EV separation methods from human plasma nowadays are either size exclusion chromatography, where EVs are isolated based on size. And the advantage is that at least the largest part of proteins and small lipoproteins can be separated away, but not all of them. And you can see this in the images later. And the second methodology is immunoisolation using a magnetic, in our case, we used magnetic beads that precipitate EVs based on their tetraspanning profile. And we used beads that were either carrying CD9, CD63, or CD81 antibodies. So we separated these different populations. So, and again, we use this incremental cycling test. You can see the rise in blood lactate. You can also see actually the rise in DNA. As I said, this was the basic interest of our collaborators in the sports department. And what we did, we isolated this time, again, blood pre and post, but also at an intermediate time point, which is defined RQ 0.9. This means respiratory quotient, and this is a quite defined metabolic parameter where you can see at this time point, it's close to the anaerobic threshold, the metabolic stress starts to rise. And so this, you can measure this during the exercise and at a quite defined time point, take the blood sample. So these three time points we compared and isolated blood plasma. Actually, we had a better pre-analytic, we controlled the pre-analytic parameters much better at this second follow-up study. And then performed different isolation methods in parallel, the size exclusion chromatography and immunoaffinity capture using the different beads, and then performed different types of semi-quantitative analysis on these isolates. And we asked for the kinetics of the release kinetics of the EVs, and we also performed phenotyping to get more information about the origin of these EVs. So where do they come from? So here you see a Western plot comparing the isolation methods, and you can see different markers, and these markers, like the tetra spannings, they rising from pre over RQ to post. And no matter which method we use, we can see this increase from pre to post, and using these different markers. But you can also see after size exclusion chromatography, for example, there is still HDL particles detectable, which are, on the other hand, not detectable when we use the immunoisolation procedure. So it seems these are, regarding the lipoprotein contamination, more advanced as compared to the size exclusion chromatography. And we detected in average about twofold increase of the EV markers, while the lipoprotein did not increase from pre to post. So we then used the Miltini MuxPlex assay to perform multiplex EV phenotyping. So in this assay, there are color-coded beads, which are coated with specific antibodies that detect surface epitopes on the EVs, which are specific to different cell types. So they can be assigned then to a cell type of origin. And then in the second step, these EVs that are captured by these beads are detected by genuine EV markers, a mix of the CD63, 81, and 9 tetraspanins. And with this, these markers can be quantified, and there can be 32 markers that can be looked at simultaneously. And this is how it looks like. This is a FACS-based method, of course. And this is how it looks like. You see the markers here at the bottom, and here the increases from pre over RQ09 to post for all the individual markers. Here, for example, for CD81 EVs. And we did this with several individuals and quantified this, the fold change of increases. And what we could see then is that intriguingly, and I really was surprised to see this, that when we compare the different isolation methods, the profile of markers that we saw increasing was very similar. So there was no difference, or almost no really obvious difference, between the CD81, CD9, or CD63 subpopulations. The profile that we observed was robust and stable. And second, when we look at the markers, we could see actually platelet markers. We could see markers of endothelial cells, here CD105, and we could see lymphocyte markers and also actually MHC class 2, class 1 and class 2 that were increasing with exercise. So this again, an illustration that the profile that we saw across all our assays was really stable. You can see all fall into a large group, and the individual isolation technologies, only a few markers are selective. Well, the CD63 was really comprising all markers, but you also can see sticking out another assay that we did, that's the EV array. And we did this actually, this was developed by Marlene Jørgensen from Denmark, from Aalborg. And this is done directly on plasma. And using this array, we only could see a few markers that were overlapping with our other results. And there were a number of other markers. So we think that this EV array, at least when performed on total plasma, does probably not really give us a picture of ExerVs. So the difference that we observed were then, of course, rather on the individual level. So you can see here on in each column, individuals and the increases from RQQ to post. You can see the darker are always the post samples, while the RQ samples are rather on the left. So this reflects the increases from RQ to post. But you can also see that there were individual differences. So for some individuals, specific markers are clearly sticking out. And we could see individuals that are high responders, strong responders, and others that are actually poor responders. Yeah, so there on the level of the individuals, of course, we observed some differences. And that actually makes sense. So we then, of course, asked, because the whole exercise field is very much focused on muscle, and the people working in exercise physiology, they look a lot for muscle EVs. And we also looked then, we were actually asked during the revision of the publication, whether we can find muscle EVs. So we looked at a few of our individuals. Here you can see an example where platelet EVs are rising very nicely. But when we look at the muscle, and maybe we have not checked the correct markers, but we have checked actually two, and sarcoglycan is actually one of them. We never could retrieve a signal, either if we look at the immunoisolated EVs or at the size exclusion EVs. Here again, you see background signals from lipoproteins and immunoglobulin actually coming through. So we couldn't actually detect muscle EVs in our ExerV isolations. But others in the field, in the exercise field, claim that they do. Then another topic, of course, since we're collaborating with the people from the sports medicine interest in the DNA, we looked whether DNA is associated with the EVs and also at the topology. So how is DNA actually really associated? Is it at the surface or is it inside or is it both? So I thought we have a very nice system here when doing this magnetic bead isolation to look at this and compare the flow through, which would give you the soluble, the really cell-free DNA or particle-free DNA, versus the bead associated DNA. And when you subject this to digest, DNA's digest, you can reveal what is actually inside and what is on the surface. I just have to look myself quite closely at this picture again to carry you through what you can see here, that only a small part of the DNA per se is EV associated. So comparing the flow through here, this is the input, comparing the flow through, which what with what we can find associated with the EVs. This is before exercise or after exercise. You can see again, there is an increase from pre to post, but the relative level of DNA associated with this EV remains the same and is only about 0.1% of the total DNA, meaning that EVs, the circulating EVs, carry only a minor fraction of the cell-free DNA, a very minor fraction. And then we still could argue that this is actually sticking unspecifically to the surface, so we performed DNase treatment. When we did this pre and post, we could bring it even further down to a basal level. And again, about 90% of that DNA, which was still associated with the EVs, was digestible here after EV isolation. And what I find quite interesting and important, the level of DNA is not rising from pre to post, meaning that the ExerVs do not carry DNA inside. If they would do so, we would see it in this assay. So there is no DNA associated with the inside, at least inside the EVs that are released during exercise. But a small fraction of it is associated with the surface of the EVs. So, and then now come back to the point of nanoparticle tracking and the influence of lipoproteins. So at some point, the colleagues in the sports department thought, so let's make a test and we give a high fat meal to the person before exercise. And those of you who have done that already, if you had a high fat meal before you exercise and you have to do it to exhaustion, this is really a tough thing. It does not feel very well. So this experiment clearly for the person doing this experiment was really, it was tough. So, but what we found out there, so this is not the experiment I was talking about. This is our basic analysis of ExerVs, and there you can see we cannot detect the increases anymore. Yeah, from pre to post, it seems here in average there's rather a decrease. No, it's on the same level. Yeah, so I think this is from one individual, and in average of several individuals, it remains the same. And so therefore we checked what happens after this high fat meal. And there you can see how this NTA looks like. The particle number that you can detect is increasing massively. Yeah. So in this individual, and this would be the fasting individual equivalent to this. Yeah. So the lipoproteins, they actually totally outnumber the EV particles, and even after the size exclusion chromatography. So we are quite convinced that the nanoparticle tracking analysis is not a suitable method to enumerate EVs isolated from the circulation after size exclusion. So we don't think that it gives appropriate number, and it does not give a dynamics of EVs over a longitudinal time in one individual. And what you also can see, what I found quite interesting, if we do Western blotting, the epitopes that we detect in a fasting individual, here you again can see the rises of the markers, you cannot detect it anymore when this individual had an high-fat meal. So these lipoproteins most likely cover the epitopes, and we cannot quantify them anymore. Yeah? So they are masking. So it's very instrumental or very important that people are fasted before blood is drawn when EVs are going to be isolated afterwards. Now, to summarize this, what I've shown you, exercise, and I've shown this as cycling data. We also have data from runners. This induces the release of extracellular vesicles into the circulation. These EVs, they are derived from endothelial cells. We have shown this by looking at cell type specific markers using the MuxPlex assay. They are derived from platelets, and they are also derived from lymphocytes or monocytes, and also from antigen presenting cells. We could not show that these EVs are derived from muscle cells, but as I said, others have studied this, and there is evidence for it. So this then gives the pool of mixed EVs that we call ExerVs, and actually now we are only at the very beginning of the whole field, in my opinion. Now it comes to study the function, what are the target cells, what are the potential functions that they are mediating, and how are they involved in the adaptive systemic response and the health-related benefits that are associated with exercise. So that's what I'm. That are the future perspectives. What are the triggers of release? There's a lot of things that we could study. What the different exercise settings in the exercise field people use. Different types of exercise, the collective, for example, young versus aging or diseases. So there is really a lot of things already at the cohort level that could be studied. Then, of course, the purification and the characterization still can be optimized. It would be really important to have single particle technologies at hand. We tried a little bit into imaging flow cytometry, which was quite promising, but again, using genuine dyes, we couldn't detect the increase which we actually expected. It would be similar to the NTA. Then, of course, we would like to look at the cargo. We looked a little bit into proteomics, and again, our initial proteomics that we did with our isolates was, at least to our opinion, not pure enough to really make claims about extracellular vesicles. Yeah, there were too many contaminating factors still around, in particular after size exclusion. So we have optimized this now regarding the immunoisolation technologies, and then we will go for the omics technologies. And then the next level would be define the target cells and design intelligent experiments to get at the function of these EVs. And of course, since I'm a neuroscientist, I'm thinking a lot regarding effects on the brain. So, and here I would like to mention at least a very nice summary that largely was written by Alexandra Bramer. And so she is summarizing her year-long experience in the work with EVs and ExerVs from the circulation. And since so many people now starting to work in this field, she's giving some recommendations on isolation characteristics and cargo analysis and so on, which is very much related, of course, to what all of us find also in the MISEF guidelines and also what we know from the EV track initiative spearheaded by Anne Hendricks. So this is just a summary where people working in the exercise field can find how to avoid common pitfalls in the EV field. And finally, I would like to thank the people. Most of the work I've been showing you today was done by Alexandra Bramer. She was a shared PhD student between me and the Department of Sports Medicine, which is headed by Pericles Simon. And thanks to all the other people helping with the exercise settings, the DNA analysis, and also the EV group with a lot of technical backgrounds very important for Alexandra to work with. So this is where I would like to stop, and maybe one final slide. So to say, let's get cured. We have already in the net available many cures regarding exosomes. Here you can see EVs or exosomes even for tissue regeneration. There is exophase, there is exobody, and even exomen. So now maybe let's do the research to back these guys up and maybe to get it right. Thank you for your attention. And I'm ready to take questions, of course.
Okay. Let's stop that. Thank you so much, Eva-Maria, sorry. It was very wonderful presentations, and we learned so much, not just about the EV exercise, but also the method and the cautions. And there's a sort of a warning how we should look into EVs in the circulation. So we've got a few questions here. I'll start with Saichiri. Can you start?
Yeah, sure. Thank you, Karuna. Thank you, it was a great talk. I have specific questions like regarding muscle. Which muscle type have you looked at for EVs?
Which muscle type?
Because various muscle types have various oxidative rate.
Okay.
It's directly proportional to the lactate levels here. So that's the reason I want to ask you, which muscle type have you looked at specifically?
Actually, we haven't looked at a specific muscle type, I have to say. Yeah. So we only took a few markers that we could get at hand and that were in the literature to check whether we can detect these muscle-derived EVs. As I said, our focus was more on the cells that are associated with the circulation, which are, immediately in the vicinity of the blood, and not so much towards muscle. But still, I mean, we can discuss this. In my opinion, it would be really difficult for a muscle-derived EV to pass the tissue barrier. I mean, there are pericytes, there is the endothelial wall, and these EVs have to pass this barrier. And I think, as far as I understand the field, and I was participating in a symposium where most of the other speakers were actually muscle researchers, and as far as I understand and understood them, the consensus is that the muscle EVs reach the circulation if you have a very heavy load of exercise and the muscle is getting kind of overloaded and hurt. You have these small injuries in the muscle, and then you get the release of the muscle EVs into the circulation. And with our, let's say, cycling exercise, probably we cannot expect these muscle EVs in the circulation. But
in the EVs, what you observed is directly from circulation, not from any other organ like fat or CNS.
We haven't looked at so this is the limitation of our study. So we had this MuxPlex panel, which contained markers that are largely derived from cells associated with the circulation, and so we only looked specifically into muscle with a few markers which we couldn't detect, but we didn't look yet. Maybe we do it in the future at other tissues. But it's still it's possible that other tissues contribute to this ExerV pool.
Yeah, I guess this is sort of the participants itself. Are they the same gender? Are they all healthy? The same age group?
And also, diet has been controlled.
Yes. So in the second study, in the follow-up study, this was all controlled. So these were all fasted. They were overnight fasting, the individuals. They were young, healthy men without any medication. So a quite homogeneous group. They had a similar status of their fitness level. So they were actually quite homogeneous group. And also the pre-analytic conditions, I think we controlled quite well in this second follow-up study. like how we process the plasma to get really platelet-free plasma, to keep it at room temperature and not move it to 4 degrees, and all these things that we learned while working with EVs in the circulation.
Mm-hmm. Okay, next question, Kenneth Verboven, please go ahead.
Yeah, okay, thank you, Eva-Maria, for the presentation. It's also a new field for me, but we are having some plans in Belgium as well to look at exercise-related EVs. So my first question is about the muscle ExerVs. As you indicated, it could not be found. Why did you use an incremental test instead of a longer test, which might increase the number of EVs released in the muscle?
Yeah, this is something that I discussed several times with the collaboration partners. So, of course, the number of experiments you can do is somehow limited. And so we never have done this longer exercise. And I think probably I agree with you, probably we would collect more EVs when doing a longer exercise. And but I think the incremental with this, we can nicely see the kinetics, the release kinetics. And I think for the starting studies, this was quite important. And also because of the collaboration partners also were interested in the DNA release and whether this parallels the EV release. Therefore, we designed the study this way. And this is the standard test that is running in the sports medicine department. And so I think, as I mentioned in the last slide, in the future, there is so many things to do. So how you do the exercise setting, and I think there is so many things to discover. So you could design this experiment in several different ways.
I fully agree with it that it's indeed a domain which has several opportunities, not only related to sports medicine, but also maybe for metabolic health and individuals with several metabolic disease. So that's
absolutely.
My second question. Are there any data about, for example, adipose tissue-specific EVs released during exercise? Because that might be an interesting way to look at for clarifying certain exercise training effects in metabolic disease.
I totally agree. This would be my very next interest I also share. And I always said to Alexandra, whenever we can get a hand at an adipose tissue marker, let's grab it and put it on your bloods. until now, we never did that. But several people in the field are thinking about this. But actually, I have to say, with exercise, I'm not aware that of a study that has already shown it. I think people look at muscle EVs that go to adipose tissue, but not at adipose EVs that go to somewhere else. Maybe the WITEM study, the cell metabolism study, but this is also muscle-derived EVs.
Yeah, but
which they claim goes to the...
There's a bi-directional communication, so also interesting to look the other way around.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, actually, Eva, Maria, how long do they have their meal prior to the test? I mean, I was wondering, like, how quickly the fat coming from the, you know, the meal going to the circulation.
I think this was, do I remember correctly, 1 hour, 1 or 2 hours. So you mean where the person has the high fat meals? Yeah, 1 to 2 hours.
Yeah. I think that's also interesting to figure out how they travel, isn't it? How they get past that? Yeah.
Yeah, so I think this is largely chylomicrons that come from the gut quite quickly into the bloodstream. And I mean, you could see it when you looked at the blood sample, you could see it immediately. It was actually disgusting. You could see it, really.
I like to see that. I think that'll be interesting. All right. The next question is from Alex. Alex Seabright, please go ahead.
Hey, Eva, great talk.
Hi.
Kind of already answered my questions by wanting to look at adipose tissue next if EVs aren't coming from muscle. The biggest source, do you think, then in exercise is adipose, or not sure?
The biggest source.
Well, yeah, the major contributor in response to exercise.
At the minute, I would say the major contributor is endothelial cell platelets and leukocytes. So I think, if I remember correctly, we were discussing at some point that we had some quantitative indications that on top of what we had detected with our markers, there is not so much left, but I do not remind myself on what basis we made this estimation and whether it is correct, of course. I have no idea, I have to say. I think there is more to learn on top of what we have shown, indeed. And adipose tissue is one thing I would look at next, I would say. But I think what we have now described is already quite a large part of ExerVs that is present in the circulation. So, but what there is next to it, it's difficult to estimate. I would think we have characterized the major part, but it's well possible that next year I have to you will teach me something else.
Great, thanks very much.
Thank you, Alex. And Genevieve Bard, please go ahead. Genevieve?
Okay. Sorry. Genevieve Bard from University of Oulu, Finland. Hello.
Hello.
I have actually two questions. I was wondering, did you do repetition of the exercise with the same people to check if the results are the same? That's the first question. And the second one is about the DNA, whether it's you have sequence data and is it random or is it enriched for some specific sequence?
So first question, we repeated tests in the first study, so the incremental test, we could see that people that are responding well and where we could detect the release quite well and the blood was quite clean, you know, it depends a lot of on the blood quality of the people you work with. So if people have a, let's say, clean blood, it's very nice to show these increases. And there we could show a very good reproducibility of the data. And we also compared with the same individuals in running and cycling. And this was comparable too. Yeah. So, yeah. Second question was, please remind me, what was it again?
I was just interested if the DNA, if you identify
the DNA. The DNA. So the PCR the colleagues use is directed to line elements, yeah, so which are random in the genome. So at least the PCR we do is random, and from the colleagues in the sports department, they haven't done sequencing yet. What they rather do is looking at methylation pattern to see where the methylation patterns to see where the DNA is coming from. But I think the consensus is that this is quite random. There are not specific sequences out there. This is across the whole genome, as far as I can tell, but I'm not an expert in this.
No, I was just curious because we did DNA from sweat-associated EVs, and It actually seems not to be completely random. So that's why I was interested if you, because my EVs were, of course, the DNA is most likely on the surface. So it would have been interesting if there is more more data on this. Thank you very much.
Welcome.
Thank you, Genevieve. Jason, please go ahead, Jason.
Hi, Maria.
Oh, hey, Jason. Nice to meet you.
Long time.
Yeah, long time. No, see.
Do you have any idea why the immune system seems to be, you know, quite prevalent in your exercise EVs in terms of what you've captured?
Could you please repeat? The quality is not very good at the minute. Sorry.
Sorry. You seem to have a lot of immune system EVs that are captured after exercise. Why do you think the immune system is so important after exercise?
So, yeah, it's the immune system, but also the platelets. I think the platelets are activated. That's known, at least partly. Mm-hmm. And at least if I remember, maybe you know that better than I do, after a strenuous exercise, people are at higher risk of thrombosis, or not a strenuous, a long ultra distance run, for example. People have a higher risk of developing thrombosis. But that was not your question. I'm sorry. You were asking for immune. But it's also well known that after exercise, there are effects on the immune system. So there are quite immediate effects that we are more susceptible to infections immediately after exercise, which may be the window where we see the EVs rising. But when they go down, actually we develop a better immunity. When we do regular exercise, I think it's quite well established that we develop a better immunity. We are more resistant towards infections, at least if we do not overload ourselves with exercise in a way that it becomes, let's say, pro-inflammatory. Yeah. So I think the immune-derived EVs may have potential function in this immune modulation that is known to occur in response to exercise. But we would have to develop some nice functional assays. And actually, I would think this is the easiest project that you could start. But I'm not an immunologist. Otherwise, I would have done it already immediately, I think. Yeah.
No.
Yeah. So, and I think together with the DNA, so the people working on the DNA load, they are quite convinced that the DNA that they measure in the exercising human is a marker for exhaustion. So the higher the DNA level, the stronger the exhaustion of the individuals, and the higher the risk that they develop a kind of an overtraining and this kind of inflammatory processes that are associated with overtraining. So it could be that EVs together in an interplay with the DNA, they mediate these kind of immunomodulatory processes. That would be my guess.
So in that respect, would you think the ExerVs is a good EV or a bad EV?
So I think, of course, it's a good EV. So it's a good EV. And as soon as the DNA comes in place, yeah, you may co-activate TLR signaling. And then it becomes a bad EV. Mm. So maybe that's the simplest view.